In order to start this review, I'm going to have to import a file at least. So I'm going to hit File, Open File. If you go on the top here, you can actually choose exactly which stage you want to go back to. This is an awesome feature. I do wish more softwares actually had this. Blender's one of them. There's a handful of others that tend to have this. This makes things a lot easier when you're working because then you can choose exactly which stage you want to go back to. So let's say I go back a couple of these and I want to go forward. Once again, I can do the same thing and it's going to bring it back. So forward and back, it's very well implemented in this software. If you want to start with a clean file, you can. You can just choose new project and it's going to clean the canvas. If you want to open a file similar to this, open file, but you also have it up here as well. You can save the file the same way, save project, that's also here. Up on the top here in your preferences, you can choose between white and dark mode. You can choose your language. You can change between millimeter or inch size, which is all very good things to have. You have automatic conversions of units, which is nice. When you save your project file, you can choose to save it in the same slice folder. You can also save your 3D printing history. That's actually the first time I've seen that option show up in the software, which is kind of nice. To get this part to work, you need to use a preset. So if you actually want to create your own preset for your naming convention, you can. You double click on this. I'm going to put Canada, and this would be more for a business that has multiple locations. You can add the part name, and then you can have the number for this. Now to save it, click the plus. And then this would actually become an option. I have not found a way to remove it. So as far as I can tell, there might not be a way to take it out once you have it in there. So you can change where you want your cache history to be. So I changed it to my scratch drive instead, which is dedicated for that. And you click on this and you can actually choose the directory that you want. The default one is the Tangle folder, so just keep that in mind. Backwards compatible, I enabled it. There's no reason not to that I can find. Orbits, you could do constrained or free orbit. I didn't find a huge difference. I did find that I preferred the constrained orbit. So if you don't like how it's rotating, you may actually want to play with this setting. Shortcut menus, these are fully customizable. They're categorized into a couple tabs, which makes it a bit easier to find. I do wish there was a search option where I could just start typing and then it would give me alternatives of what I could change. That's something that they should consider in the future. It just makes things so much easier when you're trying to set up your keyboard shortcuts. I would also like to be able to export those savings. So if I'm working on multiple computers, I'd make the changes once and then I can export those settings as well. As an added benefit, to be able to actually print it in a pre-formatted Excel sheet just to make things easier. So if you have a company, if somebody's new to the business, you can actually just hand them the keyboard shortcut sheet. It makes it a lot easier when you're trying to learn. It's very important to check release notes when you've updated the software because they'll tell you what some of the changes are. It has a check for updates as well, community and website. So that's all the basic information you would need. You can actually manually provide feedback for the software. So if you click on this, if you have an error that shows up and you can choose what you want to provide as well, you can include attachments. So if you've taken any screen caps of what had occurred, this is nice to have. It seems very simple and well put together. So for this, if you guys saw my previous review, you know that my biggest gripe was that even if you paid for a yearly license, you have to be connected every 15 days. That's not good for companies that require offline access for their software for security reasons. If I bought a monthly license, I want to be able to type in the code once a month and it needs to be an offline activation. If I bought a yearly license, I want to be able to do exact same thing once a year. That would make it so much easier for network administrators who have to do this on a regular basis. So that's something that the company should take into account. Platform definitions, if you ever need to add a printer or some changes to your settings, you can. If you click on the plus here, you can go ahead and select whatever printer you want from the list. One interesting thing is I do wish that when you exported your files, it would automatically convert it to a file format that works with that printer. Currently, it doesn't do that. It just gives you a list. So that would be something I'd like to see in the future. So you can import configurations if you need to, and you can export your printer configurations, which is good, especially if you're a bigger business and you have multiple machines that have to use the software. You can also preset your price. I haven't done any of that for this. That's your image blur and your basic printer settings. One really nice feature that the software has is if you click on here, it's going to actually show you an animation of what they're actually talking about. For your settings, we're looking at distance one. So distance one is this part here, and then distance two is this part here. That makes it so much easier to understand. It's very clear. It's a very short animation. It helps a lot. I like to see that. I did run into issues where I couldn't just double click and change it. Can't seem to be able to trigger it now, so I'm not sure how that was triggered. Settings, you can import scripts, export, duplicate the current one, and then make changes to the new one. All these are very useful. Add one, add a custom or a third-party script, which is nice. You can also delete it. So your basic settings, printer settings, tells you the resolution of the screen, the size, where you want the origin to be set up to. So all your basic settings. This honestly is pretty good. You can check your history. So if you sent this to a printer, any of your prints will actually be here and they'll show up. Should be able to repeat the print as well. I do everything offline, so I manually add the files, but in an industry setting, the one I work at, we have them wired together and then we just export the files. So that is in there. So when you're exporting the parts, you can merge everything into one single part. I generally prefer to use that, and I also prefer to have the directory open where it exported to, so if I need to make changes, I can. I generally want the supports in one solid piece so it doesn't cause any issues. There is no option to change the file name. Don't know why I didn't include this, but they really should, because if you're doing multiple versions, you probably want to save it as multiple names. In this case, you have to find the file and then rename it after you've exported it. This for the file path is just for the file folder or location it's going to be saved. It has nothing to do with the naming. So if I click on this, this is purely for the folder, and I have tested this out. It doesn't actually allow you to rename the file. That is something that they should look into adding as a feature. So if you want to fix a model, you can. There is an automatic fix option. So if you click on here, we're going to look for intersections and an update. You can see that I have 168. I can apply a standard fix to it. It'll run, and you can see that it actually fixed those issues, and we no longer have those issues present. Nice feature to have. Makes things a lot easier. I would always double check your model to make sure there is no changes though, because whenever you apply any fix in any software, there is the potential for the model to change. So that's one thing you have to double check. Another thing you can do is a shrink wrap. To be able to show you this, I'm going to have to actually create actual file. So go to file, create part. We're going to create a box and we're going to have it aligned to the corner. I'll make this quite a bit bigger, 80 instead. I'm just going to copy and paste this. I'm going to add a cone, right? And then we're going to move it. So the cool thing about this is you can select both of these files. You can go to Boolean, merge parts, or Boolean. So Boolean will allow you to subtract parts or unify them. What I can do, I want to subtract A from B. So you can see that it actually removed the cone part that was actually going through it. However, you can also unify it and it will create into one solid object. You can't actually separate the parts once they've been Boolean. So that's the only thing to keep in mind. So that becomes one solid part as of that moment. We'll undo. That part. Now there's another way to do that same operation. So with both these selected, I can go merge part. Do you want to remove the old part? Yes. And then we're going to go fix and then shrink wrap. So it's going to combine all these parts together. So this is useful if you've imported an STL or two forms of STLs and you want to combine them together. If that's the case, you're going to probably want to use the shrink wrap instead. You'll hit okay, and these are now one solid part. So if I try to separate the shells into parts, it won't allow me because they are considered one single part. However, if I've joined the part, we'll undo. So these are two parts. Is I can merge the parts. These can be undone. Even though these are one part, they're only joined temporarily. So what I can do is I can do shell the parts, move the whole part, and they become single parts once again. All right. So the Boolean tool is very useful along with the fix option. There's different cases when both of these might be more useful than the other, so just keep that in mind. File, you can create parts that you saw here that will create a primitive. There is a fairly decent selection. You can control the size. You can choose where you want the part position to be. You can save the project and you can save the project as a new file. So move works interesting. If you click and select on an object and you see this little square, it's always present. You can click on it and then move the object around. So go to the top view, click on that. It will stay attached to the build plate. So keep that in mind. If you're just doing a quick move, that's probably going to be the easiest way. However, if you want more control, the move tool actually is a bit more nuanced. So you could choose where you want your center of gravity. So you could choose the center. You could choose just one axis if you want. If you click on the plane, it'll lock that plane. So that works on any of these planes. In most cases, it's probably going to be easier just to use without the actual move option, because you can actually just click on the center and it'll move it. If you ever happen to raise it up, which is actually easy to do, you can actually go through the build plate or go up on top of it. And let's say you want to bring it back to the build plate, put it on platform, it will fix it for you. Could move it to the platform center if you want to recenter it as well. These tools are actually really good. Rotate works very similar. If you click on the center, it gives you the freeform rotation. So you can move it however you want. You can also choose one axis that you want to rotate at a time. You can enable snapping, so that will move it in increments. You can also keep the original Z position. You do that. As for the scale, I don't know why they didn't do it. The other two have actual tools that show up in the center where you can actually interactively change them. This one is restricted to numerical values, so you'd have to type in 130. It would preview it if you have the preview on. You can choose whether or not you want it in uniform. Generally, you want uniform, unless you want to skew it. I'll show you what that looks like. So if I did 150 here, you could see that it's stretched. Generally, most people don't want that. Delete one of those zeros. So just keep that in mind. The gray outline is the preview. Duplicate. This is a really interesting feature. I'm going to move this to 10. It is designed so that you can allocate which direction you want to do the duplicates in. So I want to do 4 here, and it will actually stack it. Now, this is really useful if you're printing and mass producing parts, because you set it up and you just keep on printing. This becomes very useful in that case. So this is a great feature to have. I love the fact it has it. You can change it if you need to at any time. Essentially, once you set up your total number of copies, it will preview it and show you what it would look like, and you can change essentially the layout as you go. Very well implemented. I like this. I like this a lot. The mirror option, I do wish it had an offset, because currently it will mirror right above, overlapping on the existing model. So if you're making a copy, that's where it becomes relevant. If you're not, then you're changing this. So if I hit this, that's the new model. However, if I make a copy and I hit apply, I have two models, but they're on top of each other. I would much prefer to be able to set an offset, and there is no offset currently, which is unfortunate. So you can choose where you want the model to face onto the plate. So let's say it's currently facing this direction. I want it to face whatever plane I choose. So let's say I choose this one. I want that part to face the bottom of the plane. Click OK. It will face that direction. If I want it to face the upper plane and I hit apply, it will face upwards. This is actually a pretty useful feature. I like that this feature is there. It's a pretty simple but really good feature. Orientation. This is essentially automatic optimization. I do not find it very useful at the current time, but that's because I'm also used to orienting my own models, and I'll show you the reason why. So if we set it to support area, it doesn't take into consideration the thickness of parts at all. So if I click this, these will all fail. I can guarantee it. Even with supports, these are not going to be successful, because these are designed specifically to be difficult to print, and they need to be printed at a certain angle. I think this needs to probably be adjusted for it to be more useful for a lot more people. Okay, so you can use an automatic arrangement. If you choose all parts, you can, or you could select the specific parts. It's going to automatically add a gap, your space settings here. You can choose to rotate them as well, and where you want to either center it or put it on the corner. Center is generally what I normally go with. So if I click that, it will optimize their location. Now, the hollow feature is actually fairly interesting. We're going to hollow. There is this. So you have the accuracy, you have the wall thickness, which is pretty standard. But this is the part that I'm more interested in, is the hull type self-support. The self-supported feature is really cool. So if I click on this and I show you now, you see that? It actually creates incremental fills. Like, especially for characters, this might be more useful. If you choose the infill, you'll get an infill that alternates. Now, although this is designed to help support the inside of the model, it's actually not a bad design. I am concerned that if there's not enough drainage holes, the material might not come out as easily. It is nice, though, that it does provide extra strength to the model. You will have to make sure to properly clean it. For a model like this, because it's so large, you may have to add a fairly large drainage hole in the bottom as well as the sides. The perforator is adds drainage holes. You can add a hole. You can also remove the holes. I haven't found any use for keeping the subtracted parts, especially since you can actually undo these fairly easy. The software actually does a really good job at cutting out the infill as well. As you can see here, which is kind of nice. It's a nice little feature. And if you ever have to undo it, you can undo it easily. Overall, I found that the perforator or the drainage hole option is actually very easy to use. It works well. I wouldn't actually change any of those features. A really awesome feature is the label function. So if I click on label, I can left click and drag on the model. Now that is based off the view. There we go. Test model 02. You can change the font, Roman Greek. Times New Roman, which is the standard. You can choose to have it extrude outwards or come in. You can flip the text and mirror it. Hit apply. See, it's recessed in. There is a compensation option if you need to. I haven't used this. I haven't found really any usefulness to this because the fix options are pretty good. But if you ever run into certain issues, then you can use this option as well. Then there is this honeycomb option. You choose the plane that you want it to follow. Change that to a 4 instead. Make it bigger, right? Hit okay. You can actually decimate or reduce the amount of triangles in the mesh with this mesh reduction. It's pretty good, but you will lose details, so just keep that in mind. The moment you click on an object and click the support button, all other objects on the platform disappear. So before you start creating your supports, make sure you select the correct model that you want to create your supports for, and you'll have access to the menu options. There are several preset support settings that you can choose from. For small things like this, I normally choose something that's a bigger size. However, you have two options. These contain your basic settings, and whenever you click on one of these, you will actually see in the preview menu here exactly what you're changing, which is actually really handy. It's a good implementation and a good way to explain it. If you click on more settings, you will actually have access to quite a few more options, and there's one that's in particular quite useful. So if you go to the bar section here and you choose structure, avoid nearby parts, you can see that supports will actually be generated around the model instead. That is extremely useful, especially if you're doing figures, because it will prevent supports from actually getting stuck to the surface and causing artifacts. If you want to control how many supports are actually generated or how closely they're clustered, you have to change anchor distance. So there's a couple settings in this menu here in your basic settings that you're probably going to want to change. I'm going to show you right now what that looks like. So we're going to auto-generate some supports. I'm going to go to more settings, increase this. I'm going to increase it quite a bit so that we can see it a bit better. Generate these. There you go. That one setting will control just how many supports generate and how close. So when you're playing with this, just keep that in mind. Some softwares use percentages, which is intuitively a bit easier. However, control-wise, this actually is a better setting overall. But let's say I want to do something a bit more specific. I can go to manual. These ones are the ones that are currently there. I'm actually going to turn these off so I can see them a bit better. Okay, turn these off. And then you can actually move these on and move these around. The generated supports are a pretty good starting point. I often find that they're not enough though, so you will most likely need to create your own. If you have a support, if you click on it, it will remove it. And if there's none there and you click, it will add it. This changes just how big the support preview is. This eye menu will actually turn it on and off. If you need to change the profile, you can in this menu here, up here. Although the settings are amazing, I would like to see it resemble more of a tab. So maybe a very light line here or some other visual cue that this is actually a tab. So I'm going to turn this off again. And when we want to generate a new version, you hit apply, and then it will apply the changes that you've made. This off again. I can tell you from experience that you need supports in the corners. If you don't, you will see it deforming. It's actually a bit better to do it something more like this. I always add them in the corner because that tends to be the area where it will deform the most. All right, and then we'll apply these and make them visible. We'll delete them, and we're going to go to manual. There's another way to create supports. You could actually just manually do it. So if you're going to do it, you can click this, and you can select a plane and then create a support area. So what this allows you to do is actually select multiple areas and define them as a specific support type. So once I click this, that's been defined here. So I could do tree support instead, apply it, and it will generate those supports in those two areas. Whenever it generates supports, you have two portions. You have the actual supports, and then you have the base that's generated. So for the base, I make this as small as possible, to be honest. So we're gonna mark another part here. I'm going to do these two. I'm going to hide the base so that I can see this a bit easier. All right, so we're going to go ahead and mark this as a separate layer of support. Instead, we're going to use the smart supports for figure and then apply that. So the ability to create individual supports is actually really good. I like this. There is another way to select regions. So we're going to select it using this. So you do have a brush selection, and then you can mark it. You do have a square selection to mark regions. And you do have a lasso selection as well. I will probably end up using the paintbrush one. Fine, I have better control over this. So if you're using this, you want to deselect an area, hold down shift while using the brush, and it will deselect it. So this, select entire regions. That seems to select the whole model. And this select specific planes. If you ever need to add to a current area, you can select this, then add to the current area, and then apply, and then it will add it. You can choose areas where you don't want any support whatsoever. That's actually a perfect use case for these regions here, because these are for testing the slicer options. So we don't want actually any supports in this area. So we're gonna create a no support area, and if we need to remove it, we can remove it at any time. If you want to edit the existing support structure, you can. When you click on this, you'll be able to change and manipulate areas. So you can move these around if you need to. I do find this part a bit unpredictable for the most part. You shouldn't need to really use that. I find this tool much more useful. This one currently, I find it's a bit awkward. It's not entirely clear how it's supposed to work. I would like to be able to just click on this and then be able to extend it. It seems to do it in a strange way. It looks like a possibly very powerful feature, but right now it's very cumbersome. I would like to see that modified for sure. As for the rest of the support settings and all that, honestly, they're really good as is. So let's say I wanted to export this. I would have to select the models that I wanted to export. Let's say I wanted to select all those. I'll go to slice. There's two versions. There's a regular slicing option, and there's an adaptive slicing option as well. It can save quite a bit of time depending on the type of model you're doing. So we're going to try adaptive here. You can set the plane at which you want the changes to be done and choose the type of profile that you want to use. So this is how you would change your resolution. So you can make the changes here. You can create your new profiles if you need to. What I would like to see is one of those explanatory previews that they have in some of the other ones. It's not entirely clear where what is going to print where. So I would like to see that in the future. It's nice to have the option to change at what level those print settings will change. I'll get out of that. I'm going to go for slice and just do a basic slice. Important to note is that every time you export, whether it's an STL or a printable file, and that goes towards your monthly quota. So if you select all of your models at the same time and you fill a build plate, then you can actually potentially save quite a bit of money by doing it all in one go, because then you're just exporting the one file. We're going to hit export files. Now, we don't have anything connected right now, so we're not able to send it directly to the machine, but that is an option that is available. I do want to see more types of file formats. Right now, we're pretty limited. These are pretty much only the files you have access to currently. So in order for the software to be more competitive, they're definitely going to have to increase that. So keep that in mind. This is where you can actually rename it. And you will have to choose a file that works with your machine. If you have an older machine, then the .goo file will probably not work. These are for newer machines only. They don't currently support CDB formats, which is what most machines used to be using. You will be limited in how you can export as a file. If you want to go back after you've entered this, just hit preparing. You can export as an STL, and that will solve that issue. And then you'll have to bring it into an external slicer program.